Good morning, everyone. I'm Varun. I'm from Minjar. It's basically a cloud-based arm of Visa Technologies. Actually, this might be a little out of place because I'm really not going to talk much about maps, to be truthful. This is more about processing the data and getting meaningful information out of it and the challenges we faced doing that. So I hope you don't... it's not a very long presentation, so I hope you don't get bored about it. This is just one slide of what we do at Minjar. What we do is that we have proven expertise in design, development, and management of a lot of location-based data. We basically manage Hadoop clusters for a lot of other organizations and kind of help them in moving to Hadoop and doing all their crunching, number crunching, location-based data on Hadoop and get meaningful data out of it. We have a private cloud. We have a hyperscale backup solution. We have on the cloud, basically, we have already got optimized stacks wherein you can come and deploy your applications. What I'm associated more with is the big data team, which is into looking at location-based data and crunching that data and getting information. So, everybody knows what hyperlocal is. And so to start with, so basically what we are doing with location-based data is that we get this a lot of data from other sources, and we actually, what we need to do is to extract the meaningful information from this. What we understand with meaningful information is that the data kind of we get is very raw, and you just say that at this particular latitude and longitude for this time, some event happened. Now, if you look at all those points, the latitude and longitude are at an accuracy of like 6 or 7 digits. Now, if you start to look at all this data and try to get something out of it, it becomes too messy. So it's not too good for everybody to have this kind of data. So what we do is to make sense of this data in a little different way. I think all of you would know what a tile is. So when we get this data, we actually break it up. We kind of get the hyperlocal information, which is not just where that event happened, but also in what time period this event happened. That is what makes it a hyperlocal event. And so basically when we get this data, we calculate all these scores of that data based on that, and that is where we are. So how we represent this data? This data is basically, when we get it, is basically latitude, longitude, and just a timestamp, and basically what happened in that point, what event happened, and so on. So, like you already would know, we have broken up the world in the form of tiles, and each tile is a rectangular piece with a resolution, and this has, a set of latitudes and longitudes where we can map that event. So this data can be events, photographs, location, place of interest, digital events, videos, and so on. And all this data needs to be mapped to a particular type at that particular location. So when we serve that data back, when we give that data back, we can actually say that this is event which happened at this particular location for this time period. And basically the number of events coming, and we keep doing the scoring using various algorithms, and this scoring determines how good that data is. So the way the processing happens is that we get raw scores from various organizations. There are a lot of organizations everywhere. We get this raw score, like photos from Flickr, which would have tags and keywords and so on. We extract the location and the context, the keywords, whatever keywords are there, Bangalore and so on. And Kor Mangla, there's a conference going on, that's an event which is happening. We get all this information, we adjust the scoring for this location for this keyword. And we get the tile information, we get the time period where this, at which time period it happened, which is like based up like morning hours or like weekday nights. So someone like a beer club would come in a weekday night event. So if something happened at beer club, it would come in a weekday night. And then we use this data for the prediction by doing all the scoring algorithms and so on. So getting into this, how we would do this for Bangalore. So for example, let's consider an area like Kor Mangla. Now, predicting Bangalore, what is happening there, what we would do is break it up in a set of resolutions. So if you want to do it in a 10 square meter resolution or maybe even smaller, you can break up those set of latitudes and longitudes into the set of tiles. That those set of tiles, so whenever we get an event, say a beer club, it would fall in a particular tile. Now if you look at Church Street, mostly events happening around Church Street would basically be revolving around pubs and so on. So that is what all this information. If you say in exact latitude and longitude to a sixth degree of event, to a sixth accuracy of event, I mean, somewhere in Church Street, it wouldn't make too much of a difference if we have an event happening at, say, 0.001 and 0.0002. So we don't actually do that. What we did was we took all this data and created a tile out of it. And the way we serve the data is for that particular type. You can actually change the data type. So maybe Code Mangala can be one type. Church Street can be another type. And Shantinagar and so on can be rest of the types. Now, the problem with the tile is that if you start making, I mean, what we did was we made rectangular tiles. Why we did that? Because if you start making a latitude longitude in a multi-polygon shape, it makes it very difficult for us to render that information. It's very easy to, you can use Google Maps, OpenStreetMap, whatever maps, and you can put that information on top of that. You can layer that. If it's a tile, it becomes very easy and becomes very fast. If you start making multi-polygons of everything, it becomes too slow, which is why we broke it up in this form of tiles. Okay. More of this, my presentation revolves around processing this amount of data. We actually never set up a Hadoop cluster locally. I mean, locally on a local system we did. But I mean, as such, most of the processing of all the data that we did has been on EMR. Why we chose Amazon EMR, it has, I mean, especially to start with, the biggest advantage of EMR was that we didn't have to do any hard work of setting it up, procuring machines. I mean, initially we didn't even know how we want to do it, whether it will actually be successful, whether it actually work or not. So what we did was we started running on EMR and it gave us several advantages. One was we had no headache at all of setting up clusters and so on. Just go to EMR, launch it with the number of machines you want, number of clusters you want, and then just focus on the logic. That is something, an advantage that EMR gives you. All the storage that we have is currently on S3 or Glacier, which is another advantage because you don't have to download much data. You just look at it from there. The challenges mostly that we faced, this was basically in long running clusters which were becoming too expensive. We had clusters running for over a week on M2.4 XLR machines which were just way too expensive, consuming too much of time and money. It's actually a pain to manage all the workflows. So once initially we had just two or three jobs running, and then when they started becoming workflows dependent on each other, that was the other problem we faced. Of course, if you read from S3 to this, it actually takes a lot of time to read it. And the biggest problem was that a failure of one job would cause the rest of all the jobs in that cycle to fail. How we solved all these problems. So the biggest best practices for performance that we had, we actually, if you look at it, every line of code, when you solve a problem of that magnitude with that much of data, every line of code actually counts. So, we actually optimized to that level, but instead of local variable, if you make that variable outside the class, it would give us a huge performance difference. I mean, saving almost a day of processing for us. So that was the level of, performance optimization that we did. One of the biggest things that you do need to do with Hadoop is the configurations. So the MapReduce framework, the way that it works is you can configure almost everything in the number of mappers, the number of reducers, the number of when you want to output that data, what is the sort buffer, what is the amount of HDFS that you want to use. So that is all of it that we optimized. And we have different configurations for different kind of jobs. If it's a memory intensive job, we give more memory to the mapper or to the reducer. A lot of people, when you work on Hadoop, you start writing in Pig or Hive or Ruby Python, which is more of a streaming job. We actually started using Java to write all our code. We didn't use any of Pig or Hive or the high level languages. Java is also high level though, but we started using Java and it actually got the cost down a lot. It was another day that we cut off. We did a lot of profiling, we did the heap usage and the GC characteristics. And we realized that, the mappers and users, you can't have a common configuration across. So that is something we changed. The number of disks to maximize the I/O bandwidth. Not going to detail of that, but it's basically like when you want to output that data onto HDFS, when you want to read that data, how much of it you want to read in what patches. And I already talked about picking number of mappers and users and the memory assigned to each one of them. And we actually experimented a lot with JVM reuse. So, sorry. if you, I mean, kind of start using the JVM and process that, it actually helps you a lot. This is a test that we did when we ran on PIG and through Java on Hadoop. So if you look at the data, it's actually, I should have left the boundaries, but that's okay. So if you look at the times which you had for PIG, it's around, I mean, these are the times that we had. This was for a 11 machine cluster, running around 2 maps and reduce on each one of them. And if you look at it, these are the times that we got from, I mean, just a load, filtering 10% and then reduce and so on. So it would take around 1072. After all the optimization that we did that I've talked about in the NAM mappers and the reducers and so on, this went down by almost 40%. So we cut down our time to almost half of what it used to take earlier. For data storage, the thing that is really important was tuning the iosort.mb when the data gets output onto the disk. Controlling the number of parallel mappers, that is something which is very important. Basically, if you have a lot of input, like for example, if you have like 1,000 files and you want to do them parallelly, it will happen much faster. But it will have a negative impact also because of all this processing happening, the memory, etc. consumption will change. So we kind of, for each kind of job, we optimize the number of mappers that we should run. And we started using a custom input format, which is a combined input format. So if you have, say, we have 10,000 different files, instead of sending it all to different mappers, we kind of combined these files, made them into 1,000 files, and gave them to common mappers. That helped us to reduce a lot of data transfer that was happening. We also experimented with different codec choices. We used LZO, we tried VZIP and so on, and we optimized that as well. And I mean, after a certain period of time, your processed data actually becomes a big data problem itself. So we started using Glacier to store that, and that's another problem that we are facing right now. So the amount of savings that we achieved through this was almost 100x performance increase that we had by all these tweaks. The size of machines that we used to use earlier was an M2.4xlarge on Amazon EMR, which has now reduced to an M1.xlarge, which uses almost 1/4 of memory and half of the processing part, which is a big savings in terms of the amount of time. We do a minimal amount of transfer of data outside of S3. So the only data transfer that happens is inside Amazon EMR and S3, which saves a lot of cost. And now that the workflow which I was talking about, which used to take around 2 weeks to be completed, it now takes just a few days to be done, around 2 or 3 days, which is another huge amount of savings to the ways we talked about. There are still quite a few bottlenecks that we need to solve. One is the dependent workflows. For EMR, we actually do not have too many. I mean, Azkaban and so on don't really work well. So we're actually experimenting with that and coming up with something of our own. And as I said, the amount of data that we process and store in S3, that has actually itself become a big data problem. So that is it. Short presentation, I actually didn't go much into all the EMR stuff and the tweaks that we did because I realized it's more of a map conference. Okay, questions?
Show some of your output, like the data products,
It's there on a machine, but I don't think it'll work here because it's IP block. I mean, there's only a few IPs where it works. So, I'm sorry, but I have raw data that I can show, but that actually won't make sense.
Can you give some dollar figures? What are the savings?
Okay, so dollar figures I'll actually talk through this slide. So if you look at it around, if you look at, I was talking about M2.4 xlarge machines, which would turn to M1.large machines, M1.xlarge. So M2.4 xlarge machine costs around, say, 0.25 or something dollars per hour, instance hours. And an M1.xlarge costs around $0.1 for M1xlarge. So that is around a savings of around 20, I mean, I would say, what, $0.15 per hour. And the job time, it used to be almost 2 weeks, has gone down to like 3 days or 4 days now. Plus the amount of data that we transferred has gone down to say around 20% of what it used to be. So the amount of, I would say, is around 80 to 90% cost has been reduced from earlier. So just to talk about the amount, I'll give a rough estimate of what I know is, earlier per week we were spending around $200,000 on EMR for running all the jobs. Now it's come down to around $25,000 or $30,000. So that has been a huge savings for the
per year.
This is per week that I'm talking about. So that is what it's come down to.
For Amazon development, so you have to do local development also, right?
Right.
So is how you process that data, testing and all this. What is the local development environment?
So local development environment is, a small group cluster on a local machine. The local running, we process that. But when you want to actually do that, the advantage of EMR is that you don't actually have to launch a cluster for an 11 machine cluster for running for 1 week. What we do is we just run a 2 machine cluster just for like say 2 hours, do that testing and shut it down. What it actually costs is just $0.2 and nothing much. So that's the advantage that I was talking about of using EMR. You actually don't have to, think of all the setup and where will you do the running, where will you do the testing. You have that EMR, you just go ahead, you create your jar, upload it, just run your cluster, 2 machine, 10 machine, 100 machine cluster, run it on EMR, do the testing, get the output, just to get your output. So that is something that's a huge saving. You don't have to actually have an infrastructure, we don't have to think of, oh, there's no machine available, where do I run this now? And those kind of things. So all those things, that it's on demand, so you can run as many as you want. We are using Java because earlier we started using Ruby, then we used, Ruby and Python, we actually used Pig also. So this is what I'm talking about. When we started using Java, we got huge amounts of savings on time. Around 50% of time was saved on processing.
If you try C++, you can save more, right? So why not
C++? The advantage of using Java is, you're right, what you're saying is right, the higher the language, the slower, the more time it takes. The advantage of Java is that since Hadoop actually converts all your jobs to Java eventually. So if you're writing in Pig, what Java will do is it will create a jar out of it and then run it inside Java. Because it's written in Java itself. So it expects a Java input. That's why we make a custom input format. We make a Java, make a jar, and then that's why Java helps us save some time. That's the reason. I'm not talking about that Pig is a bad language or some other thing is a bad language. But the thing is that since Hadoop is written in Java, it's the advantage we get. And it wants the input to be in Java.
Do you use some like Mahoud or something for development, or
are
you using in-house
all the things? We're using in-house most of the things. We've actually looked at various engines and so on, but there's not that much which is actually helping us out, so we didn't use that. Basically our aim is to save as much as time and as much as processing or memory as possible. So we prefer to develop new solutions. But we, whatever it is.
Yeah, earlier you said you were running a private cloud. Are you still using Amazon's cloud services?
We're using Amazon cloud services right now.
Okay.
Earlier we did set up a small system to start with, but when we actually moved to EMR, we realized that there's much less headache and you can focus on development. That is a huge advantage.
I'm not a geek, so I really don't know very much.
That's good.
The technology we're using. But in one of your slides, you said that you were making a prediction at the end.
Right.
It's something that you can make predict. And I was wondering what kind of predictions you can make.
From all this data, after we process this, the predictions that we make, it's basically for advertising. So the predictions that we make is what kind of ads to serve there. For example, if you look at the past, it's simple machine learning. If you look at the past data, that this is something that has been served here, people are interested in this, or these are the kind of things that happen here, these kind of events happen here, the pub events or conferences, then you can actually predict saying that over the next period of month or maybe on a Sunday, these are the kind of things that will happen. So for example, on a Monday morning, normally what happens is that most people would frequent a pub on Saturday night. So it doesn't make sense to show someone an ad in Wednesday afternoon for a pub. So the prediction would be that on Sunday evening that this people will probably, or maybe just saying that even to the extent that of Saturday night pub, people going living in Shantinagar go to a pub in Church Street. Or people living in Vanigatta Road would go to a pub in say Kormangala. So those kind of predictions are that is what we make. And those are kind of ads that we show.
I see. So your clients are both individuals as well as big and small businesses.
Right, yes.
I see. Thank you.
More questions?
Okay. A small presentation. Thank you.